Hey guys, welcome to Banter Blitz. So, evening show, and you know what? The weather in Germany starts driving me mad. Actually, due to this daily rain, I have not seen the sun for quite a bit lately. Just put me in this condition several years ago, and I would have definitely got that summertime sadness instead of Lana Del Rey and gave up on chess soon after. But this actually never happened, so let's play. Okay, so what do we have here? I already have some challenges, so I will just start with the one that was the first. Okay, so Duke Crusher, 5 minutes. Let's do it. And I'm playing with black. E4. So during previous show, almost everybody played something closed. So thank you very much for starting with the open. Line, okay, E5. Knight F3, and today I will start with the good old Philidor defense. So, when I was a kid, I usually played only Sicilian, mainly Nidorf. Maybe I will play Nidorf in one of our games today, maybe not. Then I switched to Philidor, and only then to classical Ruy Lopez. Okay, so knight goes to f6. A typical development move. So, and bishop to d3, well, interesting. I expected knight c3. Because with the knight on c3, white usually can opt for more aggressive setup with castling long. After bishop d3, probably white will try to castle short. Okay, so bishop d3 breaks a connection between the queen and the knight, so maybe it makes sense to attack the knight immediately. Also developing another minor piece. If white will take on c6, well, I will have damaged pawn structure on the queen side. However, I will control the center, and b-file will be open for my rook. So I will have some compensation for this strategic drawback. Okay, so let's see how it goes. So now, after white castled, I should be careful because white is ready to play f4, e5. So probably I have no time for putting my bishop on the long diagonal h8, a1. And it's better for me just to stick to quick development. That's why bishop e7. A bit passive position, but it helps me to castle very fast. And in the long run, I will try, of course, to improve the position of that bishop. Okay, bishop to f4, probably intending to play e5. I think it's better for me to prevent that. That's why I play knight to d7. Because if white manages to play e5 and forces me to capture on e5, white will have a great advantage, because the access to my weakened pawns on the queen side will be much better. Okay, queen goes to e2. Well, probably I have the time for rook b8 now. Attacking the pawn on b2. Occupying the open file. That is a programmatic move here, anyway. Rook to b1. And now it's time for further improvement of my pieces positions. So I guess I should start with the bishop. So bishop goes to f6. That was, by the way, the another idea behind knight d7 move. So not only to prevent e5, but also to make f6 square possible for the bishop to occupy. So here bishop is much better than on e7. It doesn't interfere my rook with the play over e-file. So now after bishop d2, a bit passive move, of course, I think I can continue with the rook e8, which was also planned. So e5 was opened right after e5 takes d4, which means that this file is very interesting for my rook and for heavy pieces in general. So we can see a pawn on e4, a strong central pawn. I have to exert pressure on this pawn. Okay, after f4, this pawn becomes a bit more vulnerable because now white has no choice of playing f3 at some point. However, white occupies the center heavily. Okay, e5 is a threat or not? I think no. So probably I can continue with another improvement. So my knight goes to c5. Just a normal square for my knight. Now my bishop c8 controls some squares, but as we can see, it's not so easy to develop it at the moment. I don't have normal squares for that, except for probably e6, but well, on e6 it will be not that great, I guess. Well, after queen f3, I think I can simply capture the bishop on d3, because potentially it is a very dangerous attacking piece. Without that bishop, it will be much harder for white to attack. And after pawn takes on d3, this pawn becomes also some sort of a target for me. And now I think I can develop my bishop on a6. So now it makes sense. And looks like I'm about to complete a development, which is quite good. I have a pair of bishops. Position is, however, not that open. So probably it will be my plan to try to open up a position. Well, that is a mistake, I guess. I can take on d3 simply. Mm-hmm. So I will do that. Okay. However, he can take on a7. Yeah, that's right. So now I can take on b1 or f1. I guess on f1 will be better. And after bishop takes on b8, probably I will have an intermediate bishop takes g2 winning a pawn. Or just queen takes b8. So, well, in that case, he will take on f1 probably with a queen or with a king even. So I win nothing. So I guess bishop g2 will be the most interesting move here, winning a pawn since white can't take on c7. Well, in this case, I just take the queen, and when he takes my queen, I recapture, and my bishop on f3 is not under attack, so I'm a minor piece up. Okay, miscalculation. Duke crusher. And now I think after bishop d4, I win even more material, because king has no square to go away. Okay, I can take this rook at any moment. So probably I will start with something else or not. Okay, let's not be tricky at this point, because, well, I have an extra rook. I guess it is an easy win. Okay, so creating a passed pawn and queening it should be just a normal way to win this game. Okay. Okay, I will capture the knight to have a queen on the board. Come on. Check. And checkmate. Thank you for the game. Not a bad start. So, about your mistakes, I think the decisive mistake was when you took on c7, actually. So let's see this moment, just a sec. So after bishop a6, well, first of all, bishop e3 was not that good, because it gives me a chance to take on d3, so instead of that, you should have prepared this somehow. But okay, after bishop takes d3, bishop takes a7, everything is pretty much forced. So here you took on b8, I took on g2, And here it was just a must to take on g2 with the king or with the queen, after which I have an extra pawn, but of course not an extra minor piece like here. So bishop takes the 8, rook takes the 8, and it is a simply winning position. Okay, let's go further. So, next challenge from Mr. or Mrs. Amando. I don't really know, sorry. So, let's do it. And again, one more black game. So, c4. Okay, English opening. Let us react with the e5. So now we have some sort of Sicilian defense, but with the changed colors. It is like Rosalima in the Sicilian, so I give up my bishop. However, damage a pawn structure on the queen side, so I have a compensation for it. So usually it is a general rule not to trade your bishop for a knight at early stage of the game, because you never know how the pawn structure will be changed. So position might be opened up and so on. However, there is an exception. So when you have a possibility to create some positional strategic drawbacks in opponent's camp, like here, so I managed to damage the pawn structure, then this decision of training the bishop is more or less justified. Okay, let's continue with the development. Okay, so I want a castle, just as quick as possible. And I will try to prepare the attack on the king side, actually. Because on the queen side, it's not so easy for me to play. You can see this great bishop g2 on this long diagonal. So this rook already occupies the b-file, so it's not easy, really. So my play should be there on the king side. And in the center, of course. So knight f3, okay. e5 is under pressure, but is not hanging at the moment, so probably I have the time for example rook b8, preparing development of my light squared bishop. So this move looks natural. I will do that, just protecting pawn b7. And now I guess I'm ready for something like bishop f5, for instance. My basic idea is to try to exchange light squared bishop. First of all, it will give me a chance for attack on the king side, because this bishop is the main defender of the king side. Second of all, I will get rid of opponent's pair of bishops advantage. So it is kind of multi-purpose idea, which is quite typical for this sort of positions. Also, we should understand that c4 pawn after white played d4 is more or less a weakness. So I should check every time if I have a chance to attack it directly, but I guess not right now. So maybe bishop to f5 would be the best move. At least it looks natural. Just to develop bishop with the tempo, rook on b1 is hanging. And rook goes to a1. That is kind of, well, achievement for me, right? So the rook was on the open file, now it occupies the closed file. Good. Something good already happened to me in this game. So now, I guess, queen c8 looks good. Just preparing my main idea, bishop to h3. Let's see what my opponent will do. Usually a typical reaction is some sort of rook e1 move to have bishop h1 in case of bishop h3. This, however, allows my bishop to quite active position. So it will be also not bad. Okay, my opponent starts thinking. D5. Well, I think it is a mistake. But maybe I'm wrong. Because this move just fixes the pawn structure in the center. And it's not a good idea when you have weakened pawns like c4 and c3. So it's better to keep this pressure in the center. So c4 becomes really a target. What else? After d5, bishop g2 became quite passive. So where to go with the knight? I think on a5. Of course, that is not usually a good idea to put the knight on the edge of the board, but here it has a concrete object of attack, this c4 pawn. If queen goes to a4, protect on c4 and attack on my knight, I will reply with the b6. Very flexible move. Just protecting the knight and preparing maneuver of knight b7, knight c5 in the future. Yes, I will do exactly this. So now, as you can see, I also additionally control c5 square, so I prevent this c5 move. Because c5 is kind of planned for white to get rid of this weakness. And to try to open up position, having pair of bishops. So now it is not so easy to do. Because I control c5 twice. I can even add my knight to b7 if necessary to control it three times. So I'm satisfied with my position now. From a strategic point of view, it looks very solid. Very decent. Bishop to g5. Okay, attacking my knight. I think I can afford playing f6 here. It is not a big weakening of the position because opponent's knight has no chance to get to e6. That's why I just won a tempo. Bishop to e3, and now, well, I have a chance, I guess, to play bishop to h3, exchanging that bishop. But maybe it is not a big problem for me, I mean, that bishop at the moment already, because it is no longer so active, right? Long diagonal is closed, so, well. No more danger from that bishop. Maybe I should focus on playing against opponent's weaknesses. So c4 looks tempting to attack. I will probably start with bishop d7 move, attacking the queen, just to see where it goes. Because this queen has no so many opportunities. It has to go away somewhere to protect c4. Yes, on b4 only. Now, I think of playing queen to a6, just attacking c4 second time. And after knight to d2, well, I predicted that move. I expected that because it is the only normal defense of the c4 pawn. I have very promising knight to f5 move. So as you can see, bishop e3 has no squares to go away. I can capture it next move. And this damages white's pawn structure even more. So now I have very good position. Okay, what to do now? Of course, I can flag my opponent, but it's not very interesting. So what to do with the c4 pawn? Can I attack it additionally? Well, not yet. So let's grab the space on the king side. Yeah, I won on time. However, white's position was already, well, I don't want to say lost, but very bad. Because look, so many weaknesses, c4, c3, e3, e2, all the pieces are quite passive, including that bishop on g2 and knight on d2. So I have a clear plan of attack against opponent's weaknesses. By the way, a2 is another weakness. I have some sort of potential advantage in space. All over the board, I have different ideas of regrouping my pieces. So black is definitely much better here. So how to improve white's play? So first of all, in my opinion, the move d5 was not that great. So here, when white played d5, white actually fixed own pawn structure, making own bishop very passive, and actually giving me this simple play against weakened pawns. But after knight a5, I guess the only possibility to make this position not so easy for black to play was c5. So using the fact that e5 pawn is vulnerable at the moment, so if I take on c5, for example, knight takes on e5, and now white has an advantage in the center, because look at that, e4, f4, and so on, grabbing the space, controlling the center heavily, and everything goes just fine for white. So after c5, I would have probably ignored this threat. I would have probably played something like b6, maybe undermining the pawn and forcing some changes in the pawn structure. Maybe I would have done something else, but anyway, it was the last chance to change the situation with the pawn structure. In the very beginning, in my opinion, after this d6 move, it's better for black, it's better for white to play in a more flexible way. So white is not in a hurry to occupy the center, because anyway, white has more chances to do that. White has simply more pawns and a better control over the center at the moment. So in my opinion, it is better to play a kind of d3 move. So to have this option of playing d4 at the proper moment. So as you can see, in this case, c4 is not that weak. I have no access, direct access to c3 pawn. So white has a chance to differ the plans here. Not only d4 is possible. For example, a typical plan is to play e4, f4, just to grab the space. And another typical idea is to put the knight on f3, and then to direct it to d5, actually a good outpost. So for example, after castling, and let's say bishop d7, knight usually goes to e1, then to c2, and then finally to e3 to occupy d5. One of typical plans here. Okay, and of course, yeah, we have an interesting comment here. The third move, knight d5, is interesting. Exactly, so after bishop b4, in my opinion, knight d5 is the main line, and it is the most aggressive approach. So here, black has a chance to play a5, just protecting the bishop, or just to go with the bishop back. But in general, white secures at least a tiny advantage here, but sometimes can play for more. Okay, good. So let's get to another game. So challenges. A lot of different challenges here. Let us play to, let's say, Colleen Cohn. And again with black. What is going on? Come on. The third game with black in the row. Well, it is everything because of this bad weather in Germany, I believe. Okay, knight f6. A bad weather changes everything. c4, e6. But okay, let's try to be not that classical, okay? So I'll play c5. I played this opening several times in my life. I was not really satisfied with the results, because the character of that positions are probably simply not mine. However, it's Blitz, so why not to try to play something sharp? Because black takes a strategic risk now. White usually has an advantage in space in this opening. So e4, okay, bishop to g7. But black has some sort of interesting dynamic play. So my bishop is already on the long diagonal, as you can see, so I can exert some pressure. At the same time, I will prepare something like b5, b4, also quite natural here because I want to clear this diagonal for my bishop to activate it to maximum. Okay, so for white it is a typical maneuver to get the knight to c4 through d2 and to stop my b5 plan with the help of a4. A general rule for this Benoni pawn structure is that due to advantage in space, black usually experiences some problems with coordinating the pieces when he has all four minor pieces on the board. So one of typical ideas for black here is to try to exchange at least one minor piece, after which this regrouping and coordination will be easier. So a typical idea here is to play something like bishop to g4. I think I can try it right now. Since white didn't play h3 preventing that, I can put my bishop on g4. And pay attention, it is usually very hard to find a good place for this light-squared bishop. That's why it is a good idea just to get rid of it in the opening stage. So now, as you can see, all my minor pieces can occupy normal squares. Okay, so what to start with? Let's say rook to e8, occupying the e-file and exerting some pressure on e4, at the same time controlling e5 square additionally. Next move will be probably a6, preparing b5, and at the same time preparing queen to c7. Also a natural square for a queen here. Okay, queen c2. Let us do it. So a6 looks logical, with the idea of b5, grabbing the space and trying to kick knight c3 away from c3, which increases my chances to exert pressure along diagonal h8, a1, and at the same time forces the knight away from the center, which makes e4 pawn more vulnerable. a4, natural reaction, no questions. So now I have a choice between playing b6, preventing this a5 move, or just ignoring that, continuing the development with the help of knight d7. Not sure which will be better for me. Well, I will try to ignore. I will try to play knight d7. Because if white plays a5 himself, at some point I can play b5, and after the exchange I will have an open b-file, which is also quite a typical idea for Benoni pawn structure. Bishop to e2, preparing probably f4 move. Okay, so now I have to be careful. So actually, f4 is not that dangerous itself, but at the same time, I have to find a plan here. So I have an idea of playing c4 at some point, trying to get with my knight to c5. Is it necessary to put my queen on c7 or just to try to do this, attacking e4? And if, for example, bishop goes to d3, I will have different ideas connected with the c4, but f3, well, this is a weakening of the king's side. Can I exploit it immediately? I think no. So I will make this move. Maybe not very typical for Benoni, but I have a clear plan. I want to play c4, then probably knight to c5, to b3 or d3. Yeah, if bishop c4, I have a tempo move of knight e5, which looks also quite interesting. Maybe knight b6 was a bit better than immediately c4, and then knight through d7 goes to c5, because on e5, my knight's position is not that safe, because white is about to play f4. Well, but this gives me a chance just to capture that bishop. And I will do that, because now I have even less problems with coordination of my pieces. I have an upper hand in development. I have better chances to perform b5, but after a5 it is not possible. But I have some interesting light squares in the opponent's camp after his light squared bishop went away. So I guess c4 followed by knight e3 will be just great for me. Nobody writes anything in comments section. Just tell me if everything goes okay with the translation. Bishop goes to d2. Well, good idea, I guess. So, knight goes to d3 now. Bishop to c3. What about just taking that? Okay, thank you very much for this comment. Knight takes c3. So, let us seize a control over dark squares as well, since they are weakened in opponent's camp. So as you can see, my bishop went away, so now I replace this bishop with the queen. So I had a control over dark squares with the help of the bishop. Now I need my queen to replace the bishop. Okay, now I think of doing something like h5, h4. Rook a4, okay, I think I have the time for h5 move now. I just want to play h4 to fix all the pawns on light squares, which means dark squares will be weakened forever. Okay, queen to d2. Let's do this h4. Looks like it's possible. Yeah, but maybe it was better to prevent that. Okay, queen d4 check. What is next? Not really sure. Not really sure, but okay. Let's try to be a bit aggressive. So now e-file is open. I have an access to e3 square, which is quite good. Okay, now I can put my rook even here, creating sort of queen g1. Oh my, now it goes to e2. That is what I missed, but I have this. Yeah, everything is fine. Rook, come here, pawn. One more step, and black wins. Okay, so your mistakes, my friend. First of all, it is a good idea to prevent black's bishop g4 idea. In many cases, it helps. So, for example, after g6 and e4 is okay, bishop g7, bishop e2, castles, and here I think that h3 deserves serious attention, just preventing bishop to g4, or you can do the same, to prevent bishop g4 with another move. It is knight to d2. So anyway, sooner or later you will put your knight on c4, so knight e2 will be necessary to make, and this move, as you can see, helps you to protect e4 pawn and to prevent bishop g4, which means black will have all four minor pieces on the board, and this just interferes with black's main plan of coordination all the pieces. So believe me, it is a typical drawback of Binoni. If you have all four minor pieces on the board, well, you have problems with finding suitable squares for all of them, because white has an advantage in space. So 92 is probably a good improvement, and in further play you also made several inaccuracies in my opinion. So never give up a light squared bishop, despite it looks a bit passive, especially after you play f3. Well, potentially it is a very useful attacking piece, and also this bishop controls b5 square, preventing black's b5 plan. And what is more importantly, just protects all light squares in your position. So as you can see, after your light squared bishop went away, I had no problems with occupying light squares in your camp. So I did that quite easily. So let's see this moment. Yeah, here, after knight c4, look, queen c4, knight d7, just the knight goes there, knight e5, queen c2, c4, and now I have a chance to play knight d3. So you allowed me to activate my pieces to maximum. That is not a good idea when you play with white and when you have advantage in space. Okay, cool. So Spiltz writes, I like your Tuesday training show, but what happens when there is no forced win and you just need to find a good move? Can't spend tons of time every move looking for wins. Well, an interesting question. Actually, you should have a feeling when to search for tactics and so on. So I will describe this problem in future shows, so just stay tuned. Okay, so next challenges. Okay, who wants to play? I guess everybody wants. But let us play to the guy called Alekhinin, because, well, during the previous show I failed to win the game, which was very promising. I actually lost on time. Well, I didn't lose on time, I actually managed to finish that in a draw. But anyway, let's continue our encounter. Come on, the next game with black pieces. Why? Just tell me why. Another back in chess 24? I don't really know. Okay, e4. So I wanted to play c5, but not against you. Okay, so I'll still stick to e5, my classic. Oh, and we played 3 minutes. Well, you're cheeky, man. Okay, 97. The first rule of winning the game in chess, try to surprise your opponent. Okay, I just try to do that. C3. That's interesting. Okay, let's clarify the things with the bishop. Takes, takes. Pawn takes. Okay, I have a damaged pawn structure, but I have a pair of bishops. Should be quite quick here because I have no time for anything but playing. So, knight to c3. To activate the bishop or not, or to prepare something like c5, or just to undermine the center with the help of f6. Let's try f6. Looks interesting. I don't believe if white plays e6, this pawn will stay alive. So this gives me a chance to open up a position. That is exactly what I want when I have a pair of bishops. Knight takes. Okay, let's take it. It helps me to continue with the development. At the same time, I can attack the rook. And to improve my bishop's position. So now both my bishops look into the king's side. Interesting. Rook to e1. Okay, can I win with the help of rook takes f2? Let's calculate. Rook f2, king f2, queen h4, check. If king goes back, then queen takes h2. If king goes to the center, then probably I will checkmate it. Well, or can I just take on h2 instead, then queen h4, queen f2, and then rook goes. Rook left. Can I win there or not? Not quite sure. Okay. Maybe just queen h4. Well, then g3. Not so clear as well. It's very tempting, actually. So what to do? Okay, let's go fun. I may lose this game quickly because I didn't calculate everything to the very end. It's not possible when you play Blitz, actually. But looks at least annoying to white. And fun. For you guys. To see how International Master loses the game due to a stupid sacrifice. Okay, check. Please move to e2. Okay. Okay, bishop g4 with the tempo, and then my rook goes to e8, or bishop f5, just controlling d3. Or check on f4, and if king d3, then bishop to f5. Well, yeah, this looks really nasty. So queen to f4. Check. One more check. Okay, at least an exchange. So, what to do now? My queen is hanging. Bishop b4. I want to play bishop b4. But I don't have a chance, actually. So, okay, let's take on h2. Instead. Queen to g4. Okay. Okay. So now a4 followed by rook b3, for example. Okay, let's start with this first. Queen to e2, now a4. Yeah. I want to put my rook there. Okay, I take it. Let's put my bishop here. Okay, it's time to go back with the queen. Check. Oh, God, it was a mistake. But okay. I lost on time. Okay, but actually, rook c2 wins here, the bishop, and so on. But yeah, probably it was just not enough for me. But let's see, I think I should have win easily after this sacrifice. So one moment, please, that's really interesting. So rook f2 was definitely correct, I believe. So after queen h4, he moved the king to e3, so here. Queen f4 looks really tempting, but as we can see, the king just hides there after this knight e4 move. So maybe I should, for example, just start with bishop f5, preventing king to d3. So what to do here? So now I have, in addition to queen f4, now I have a threat of, for example, playing rook to e8, which is also quite annoying. Maybe king d2 now, but I don't believe it can go far. For example, bishop f4 simply. And what is next? Rook to e3 looks like the only move, because if king e2, then bishop g4, I win a queen. So rook e3, then just queen to f2, one more check. If, for example, queen to e2, bishop takes e3, so I won the rook back. looks just winning. For example, after king to d1, the only move. Well, unfortunately, I don't have bishop to c2 because simply king takes c2 and queen on e2 is protected. But okay, here I have at least an extra pawn, right? So yeah, here almost everything wins. Let's see what I did in the game. So I play queen f4, king here. Maybe bishop f5. Well, bishop f5 looks nice. Knight e4 to take with the pawn. Well, not really. Okay, bishop takes, king goes to c3. And here I took on h2. Maybe that was not a good idea. For example, queen f8 looks here quite devastating, actually, creating a threat of bishop to b4. So what to do? a3 looks like the only move. Now I can play, for example, rook to b8 again. The same idea, bishop b4 takes and takes with the queen with the checkmate. So queen to a4 looks like the only defense now. Only normal defense, I mean. Now I can continue with some sort of, I don't know, maybe even c5 move. Just undermining the center, opening it up, and so on. Maybe not c5, but queen f2 also looks great. Because white's queen is pinned to c2 square, rook is hanging, bishop can't move because of queen b2, and so on. Yeah, so an easy win. So probably queen h2 was not correct, and the main problem with my play here with that, I spent too much time on thinking in the opening and then before playing rook f2, so I had no enough time to make decisions, normal decisions, in a critical moment of the game when it was necessary just to finish it. Okay, Alekhine, and see you next time. Believe me, next time I will win. I will try at least. Okay, so let's get back to challenges. So, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, 5 minutes. I hope that I will play with white this common game, because I'm tired of playing with black. I don't really understand why it happens. All the games, and I play with black. I won't be terribly surprised that I will play with black. Oh yeah, now I play with white pieces. That's great. Knight c6, okay. Knight f3. I don't like the idea of playing d4 and giving black a chance to just confuse me, so let's get to something like, I believe, Scandinavian. Oh, no Scandinavian. Okay, queen goes back to d8. I usually see that queen goes to a5 in this situation. Okay, let's occupy the center. e6, well, then that is too passive. That is too passive. So how to develop my pieces now? I have several ideas. For example, one bishop can go to f4 maybe, but yeah, this makes no sense actually. So I have a chance to put my bishop here on the long diagonal again, which is usually quite annoying. So let's do it. Yeah. And then I will try to exert the pressure along that diagonal. Okay. I'm not against. Just take my knight on c3 if you want. Castles. So what is next? Probably I will try to occupy the outpost on e5. But first I want to just clarify the situation with the bishop. If he wants to take, well, he's welcome, right? I'll have a pair of bishops. And position is not that closed. Of course, my pawns are not the best pawns on earth, but, well, at least I have very solid central position. Okay, rook b8, strange moves. I don't really understand the idea behind those. Bishop to d7, come on, this gives me a chance to play bishop a3, preventing castling. Okay, knight e7. What about just d5, huh? Maybe too much. A typical idea to open out the center when your opponent's king is not castled yet and you are completely developed, but doesn't look like a good move. So maybe just to play c4 to prepare that, but then he castles, and also he has a chance to occupy c6 square with the bishop. That is another idea behind knight e7 move. So probably it's time to occupy e5. Very natural move. Activating the knight, activating the bishop g2, exerting pressure on that bishop on d7, and hoping for bishop takes a4. Okay, what is next? Let's just put my pawn on a5. Trying to, you know, to fix b7 pawn or something like that. And if black plays b6, probably it makes sense to play even a6 here. Just, creating that possible passed pawn. If a6, bishop b5, c4, bishop a6, bishop takes e7 and takes on a6, so that looks great, but I'm not sure I will have enough defense, after all, to that pawn. But okay, looks rather typical. So whenever a position becomes open, I will have this great possibility to exploit the power of the a6 pawn. Okay, so now bishop b5 is kind of a threat. No, it's not a threat. So I can continue easily with the rook e1 now. Knight goes to f5. Well, how to improve my position even more? Just c4, grabbing the space and preparing d5. Why not, after all? If I will have some problems with the d4 pawn, I can protect it with the c3, so I have two of those on the c-file. Okay, b5 gives me a chance to occupy c5 square with the bishop, and this looks really natural. So now a7 is hanging, and I can't see a normal defense. Yeah, position looks very promising. It's crumbling. Okay, I'll take that. I will take that with pleasure. Did you remember my consideration when I thought of playing a6 or not? I actually wanted to do something like this. So now my pawn looks like decides the game. Okay, just come back. Next move will be a7. Or not? Yeah, why not? A8 is coming, but knight e5, well, sort of defense. Okay, rook a4, bishop a4, knight takes c4 is possible. Knight takes d7, queen takes d7, rook a4, queen a4, and then queen a1, just simplifying the situation. Also should be winning. Which is better? Which is better? Not quite sure. Oh, a8 is an interesting idea because bishop on d7 is hanging, right? So let's do it. I hope I didn't miss anything. So if rook takes, queen takes, knight takes d7, extra minor piece. If queen takes, then knight takes d7 immediately. Yeah, you're right. As debates, correct. So rook a4, queen a1 was also good. Okay, extra minor piece. Resign, my friend. Resign. Don't you want to resign now? C3. Okay. Just go back. F6, okay. Go back. Not a problem when you have an extra minor piece. You can afford this sort of passive moves. Okay, I will capture this. I want to simplify a position to maximum. Rook e6 was probably even better. But I don't have enough time. Okay, let us simplify a position. Well, I should be more careful because, well, my bishop on c5 is out of play at the moment, but my opponent resigns. Well, thank you very much. Actually, after queen g4, things were not completely clear. I mean, having this time pressure, but okay. Thank you. So, what's next? Challenges. I've started playing with white. That's great. Maybe I will continue playing with white after that. Maybe not. You never know. Okay, so let's get this one. Yeah, one more white game. Thank you very much. After this, so I don't remember, 4 or 5 games in a row with black, another white play. White game is quite good. So e4, where is my opponent? e6. Okay. Well, let's play in the style of a kid. Yeah, so typical King's Indian attack in the French defense. g3, bishop goes to g2, then castles, then rook to e1, preparing e5, knight f1, h4, knight h2, and so on. So very easy play for white here. So one of best openings for playing in Blitz, I guess. So let's do it. e5, okay, knight to f1, then h4, so all the moves are quite easy to find and easy to make. Rook goes to c8, okay, knight goes to h2 then. Just preparing knight to g4. Didn't Fischer play this opening? Well, I don't remember, maybe yes. After c4, I just close the center. When you have a good solid center, you can completely focus on the attack on the king side. Okay, so what to start with? Let's play this. Knight g5. So, my plan is to put my queen on h5. Okay, but my pawn on d4 is hanging, so let's protect it. a5, okay. So, can I play queen h5 now? I guess I can. Let's do it. h7 is hitting. Okay, there is a typical idea to play knight g4 to sacrifice the knight and then to sacrifice another knight on f6, but I don't know. I don't want to take those risks. So I just go away a bit, and then I will capture on h6. Knight e4 is now possible in view of c3. Okay, let's prepare everything carefully. b3. Counterattack, yeah. Okay. Let us do that. I think I can forget about this queen side. I have interesting objects there on the king side. So let's try to sacrifice something there. I have so many pieces ready to tear opponent's king apart. So it should be something. It should be something at least. Okay, I like my light squared bishop, so let's regroup. I want my bishop on d3 to join the attack, because on g2 it was quite stupid. Knight to b4. Okay. Isn't it time to sacrifice something? I guess it is. So let's do it. Should be interesting at least. But maybe not correct. I don't have enough experience here, so everything might be possible. Okay, queen f3, what is going on? So, I will put my knight on g5 with a tempo. Now my bishop to h3. Okay, I will capture that. So I have, how many pawns I have? I think enough to compensate a minor piece. Knight e6 is coming. Okay. Oh, thank you very much. That was very generous, right? Okay, take it. Come on, take this pawn. Oh, thank you. Yeah. How much time? I have only half a second. Half a second. Whoa. Ooh. Okay, I will never play this King's Indian attack again. I have no experience. So... That was again the 3-minute game, right? So I should be careful with choosing the challenges, because, well, 3 minutes is not for me, at least right now. Okay. So well, let's play 5-minute Durchspielt, and I'm black. Okay, so after 2 white games, I can play 1 more black game. I'm not against. And again, something closed. Okay, c4, e6, preparing d5, knight to c3. Well, here I have a choice, of course, between playing something like d5 and getting to Queen's Gambit. But I don't really like it, so I will play something less. Something less symmetrical, okay? Queen to c2. Good response. Okay, e4 is prepared. I'll castle. Let's see if it works. Okay, I take it. So now White has no drawbacks in the pawn structure, so I should be extremely careful with my pawn structure. So I gave up a dark squared bishop, so a good strategy for me should be to put my pawns on dark squares, just to limit this dark squared bishop that has no counterpart. So I just do it. D6, E5. Bishop to B2. Okay, how to continue? Where to put my knight, for example? Usually it goes to D7, I guess. Then to just to support E5, because white will play D4 sooner or later. I can start also with the B6, just developing my light squared bishop. So let's try it. It looks less natural, but looks like it is playable. D4, well played. I can take on F3 now, but this will be too much, I think. So instead, it is better to take care of E5, but looks like I've just lost a fight for this square already. Not very good. So I played opening definitely not well. Okay, so what to do with the e5 pawn? Can I sacrifice it just to play knight e7, takes on e5? Then what? Then I have nothing, so I'm just down a pawn. Knight to e4 now, queen goes to c2 easily. I still have a problem with that pawn. Okay, I will try to give up both bishops, but it is extremely dangerous and definitely not correct from a strategic point of view. So I want him to play d5. This is not bad, of course, for white, but at least there is no longer a pressure against my e5 pawn. So I can try to regroup my knights and to do something useful. Okay, and this gives me a chance to do an interesting operation. So first I take, then I check. And now I have to close diagonal, or maybe to continue with the queen d7 with the idea of queen h3 check, but this check is probably not that dangerous to my opponent. But actually it looks interesting, so I will start with this queen d7 move. At least it is a developer move, so I improve my queen's position. Okay, h4 was quite natural to play. And now what to do? To double my rooks over e-file or what? Or to play d5, trying to change the pawn structure. But then c5 might be annoying, just grabbing the space heavily. But this also, at the same time, will make bishop b2 quite stupid. Okay, I'll try it. Looks interesting. At least it looks logical, right? So my opponent did everything to open up a position and to play d4, d5, and I prevented it. So okay, after b5, where to put my knight? On e7, then to f5, looks natural. So I will do that. c5, okay. Do I have to do what? To blockade opponent's pawns on the king side, right? So I will start with this move. Locating h-pawn and intending to occupy f4. Another knight will go to g6 just to support that knight in this plan. This already looks quite good, I guess. Okay, so now it goes to f4. Why not? Bishop to b1. Well, let us protect this diagonal, and now it's time to activate my pieces, but I can see that this pawn is not protected, so let's capture it. then knight e2 is possible. Okay. Some extra material, but no time as well. What did that? Oh, thanks God. Bishop d3 was trapping my queen. Queen a2, rook a1. Wow. The first time I just blunder so seriously. Okay. All the pieces to the king side to attack. Okay. Check. Rook takes e1, bishop goes away, rook takes f3, queen h3, no, too complicated. Two bishops are dangerous. Okay, take my rook on e8. Come on, let's remove it. No. Okay, then I'll take here. Now I'll take here. Okay, one more check on e5. No. Okay, no problems. Okay. Wasn't the best decision of mine. Is the checkmate there or not? Okay, king is in a safe place. Now I have to find a checkmate quickly. Queen to g1, rook h3. Looks promising. Yeah, okay. 9 seconds left. That's great. So, actually here, when I played rook to e6, after I won the material, right? So, queen e2. So, you play king to g2. Just going on to my screen. Okay. So, king to g2. I played rook e6, looks like it was a mistake because of bishop d3 move. So where to you move my queen? I have only one square here. It is on a2, and then rook goes to a1. And I have no squares at all. That's a problem. So actually after bishop d3, looks like I have to play something like rook takes e3, right? Oh yeah, this wins. Actually, I underestimated this idea, so after bishop takes e2, I take the queen. Come on. Yeah, that's why it doesn't work. Okay. Bradley Hamilton. Yeah, rook e3 wins, actually. So I thought that after rook e3, bishop e2, during the game, I mean, I thought that after rook e3, bishop e2, I have to take the bishop with some compensation for missing queen, but now I can see that, okay, queen is hanging on c3 as well. Okay, then this didn't work. That's good. So my game wasn't that bad. Well, another game. One more. With black or with white. I don't actually know which color. But probably it's not so important. Blitz enemy. Blitz enemy. Okay. Be my Blitz enemy for this game. And with black. Yeah. Today is definitely a day of playing with black pieces. Okay, e4 ends well. In the very beginning, I told you that I will try to remember the Neidorf, so I played that when I was a kid, but never played that after that. Okay, f3, how to play here? e5, d5, or something like e5 and bishop to e6. I guess e5, well, a6 first, c4, e5, then bishop to e6, something like that. Okay, let's try. Okay. Knight to c3. Interesting position. But not so great at the same time, so white has more space. And I have no idea what to do here. So I'll just continue development. It can't be very bad. Bishop to e2, okay. So let's get to c4 pawn, let's try it. b3. So how about queen to a5? Is it a good idea or just a complete bullshit? Then something like knight d5 will be a problem. Yeah. My opening in this game was definitely wrong. My opening choice was definitely wrong. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. It's interesting to get rid of the dark squared bishop. It's completely passive, but how to do that correctly? Well, let's try this, just this direct play. Okay, then knight to e8, protecting d6 and intending to play bishop to g5. It can't be completely wrong because it helps me to get rid of the wrong piece. Knight, rook to d1. Okay, let's make some prophylaxis, maybe. Like king here. Maybe I will play f5 then. Yeah, my position, I'm sorry for that word, but it sucks. Knight to b4. Just going to d5, very natural. I can't do anything with that. Yeah. Really, really boring position for me and very pleasant for my opponent. Okay, can I do something active like f5? But this just weakens my position even more. Okay, let's try to simplify it. Attacking the knight. So if knight goes to d5, I capture that knight. If knight takes, I take on d2, bishop takes, rook takes. Well, my opponent will be actually a bit better anyway, but at least I will have a chance to put my knight on d4 in that case after his dark squared bishop goes away from the board. So, okay, bishop takes d5 first. Well, maybe this also works. So knight on b4 is hanging now. That's why he can't take my pawn on g5. So after I managed to exchange dark squared bishops, my position never looks so awful anymore, because at least I have a chance to put my knight on d4. That's my plan. Okay, let's take that. And now what to start with? To go there immediately, knight c5, then knight e6 and knight e4. Well, I think I don't lose anything, so why not? Yeah, 2 minutes down, that's right. So I have to be quick. After my knight occupies d4, well, he can actually sacrifice the exchange, but okay. Yeah, another possibility that I missed. Now d6 drops. But then my knight goes to d4. Well, I will have a compensation for it. So let's do it. Immediately or after knight takes on d6. Well, let's try this opportunity. The rook is kind of a bit misplaced, but it's not a big problem for white, I believe. So let's protect everything at least. And closer to the center. Yeah. Bishop is being activated now. Have some tricks, of course, but they're not enough, I believe. Yeah, I was completely outplayed in this game. I will never get back to Sicilian. I forgot completely how to play that. Okay, still one pawn down. That's bad. Yeah. After this stupid game, this episode of the Banter Blitz becomes not, definitely not the best of mine. Let's come back to d4. Maybe I will have a chance to finish it in a draw. Oh, he sacrifices an exchange. Very interesting decision. But he has a decent compensation. That's true. Let's activate everything which is possible to activate. Okay, one more check. Maybe not that useful. Takes just on g6. What a shit I play. Oh God. Lost in time. Yeah, I deserve this loss, actually, guys, because I played like a moron from the very start to the very end. Okay, thank you for the game, Blitz enemy. After this game, you truly became my Blitz enemy, so I will try to win next time. But next time will be next time. Okay, so I guess it's time for the last game of today's disastrous show, because, well, I played so stupid game. Okay. So the last one. The last one for today. Okay, I will play to the most active contributor to the comments section. So is the Bates, I think. And again, one more with black pieces. So no more Sicilian. Just play normal chess. Rui Lopez. Knight f6. Castles. Bishop to e7. Continuing the development. Rook e1. Pawn e4 is protected, so now it's time to protect my e5 pawn. It was indirectly attacked in the view of bishop c6, followed by knight e5. So now it is safe. And I can focus on development. Okay, a bit transposition, so it's not really important which move to make first, c3 or h3. It is a typical combination of moves for classic Spanish. And now a4. Well, the main line starts after knight e2, but okay, a4 is also playable. Now my b5 pawn is hitting, since I can't take with the a6. My rook will be hanging on a8, so bishop goes to d7 just to protect the rook there. And to complete the development. Of course, I occupy a bit passive squares with my pieces, but it's not forever. So the main idea of this opening line for black is to control the center safely. So e5 point is very important, is of the greatest importance here. So if I lose e5 somehow, for example, if I take on d4 and I don't have sufficient counterplay, well, white usually has a great advantage. Okay, knight to d2, and the typical idea is to put the bishop on f8 just to improve its position, and also to add another protecting piece to e5 square. So I will do that. I guess I don't miss the tactics. So bishop f8, bishop takes f7, king takes f7, queen b3, check. Well, I can easily go to e7. I guess I will be saved there. So yeah, g5 is protected, so no problems with that. But if you play this with black, you have to check the possibility of bishop f7 every time, because it's kind of typical blow. As we can see, black's pieces are quite passive, not very well coordinated at the moment, so some sacrifices are possible. Bishop to c2, protecting e4. Okay, I can stick to g6, bishop g7, just a typical idea of improvement of the bishop. I can also think of probably just playing ed4, cd4, knight b4, then followed by c5. But maybe it's better to start with the g6 first. This move can't be bad. I control f5 square, I prepare bishop to g7. Why f5 square is so important? Because typical maneuver for white is, yeah, knight f1, knight g3, or e3, and then to f5. Okay, well, so what is next? What about just taking on d4 to open up the e-file and then in case white recaptures with the pawn, something like knight b4 looks tempting. Just attacking this Spanish bishop. And in the same time, exerting some pressure on e4. Knight to g3 protecting, but now I can capture the bishop. I have a pair of bishops. That's not a bad result. Actually, c7 is hanging. So, looks like this move deserves serious attention. I just want to improve my pawn structure. I don't want to get this backward pawn on c7. Okay, and typically after e5, black has a choice between, for example, knight d5 move or just capturing on e5. So I have to understand if d e5 and d e5. Well, after d e5, d e5, oh, I can put my knight on d5, I guess. Everything will be more or less fine. After d e5, knight e5, I can put my bishop on e6, but then knight g6 might be annoying. Yep, so after d takes e5, knight takes e5, it's better to take on d4 instead. Winning a pawn, and looks like everything is okay. So, let us just take this risk. Okay, this move I didn't take seriously, actually. For no reason, by the way. So e5 is hanging, right? Right. How to protect that safely? Queen b8. Or maybe there's just bishop c6. Yeah, bishop c6 is an interesting idea, because if knight takes e5, then bishop takes g2. Looks promising. Yeah, we'll try that. Okay. Very important pawn it was, but c6 looks very promising. So I have to capture an h3 actually. Is it really possible? Maybe yes, why not? Oh, I don't have much time. That's pity. Okay. Yeah, it should be a draw. But who knows? Blockade in a pawn. Yeah, psychological pressure. So I understood that it will be extremely hard to win this position having so low time. But actually, I guess after bishop c8, you had a win. So after bishop c8, I'm not quite sure, but knight f5 looks right. Just very impressive. So g7 is hanging, right? And if I take the knight with the bishop, queen takes, and how to prevent c8? So I actually can't see it. So after knight f5, probably white wins. I don't know, but looks like that. So g7, it's very hard to protect. So maybe something like knight to e8, but well, it's very hard to believe it works. So knight g7, or probably bishop g7, knight takes g7, knight to h6, king to h. Well, maybe after knight e8, I still can survive it. Yeah, maybe it works. But knight f5 anyway was very annoying, at least. Okay, so to the very end, I started playing really bad chess. So in the very beginning, it was much better. But come on, maybe the key moment was when I sacrificed the rook on f2 against Alekhine and actually lost on time. So psychologically, it was very tough. I wanted to win, and everything said that I should have won, but it never happened. But okay, so I'm satisfied that your play, folks, becomes better and better time after time. So it becomes more and more complicated for me to win games against you. So just play the same way and follow my shows, probably. Follow shows of other great guys here in Chess24, and you will improve. So thank you very much for this interesting experience again. See you next week on Tuesday first with the Training Tuesday show, and then just like today on Wednesday with the Banter Blitz. Take care. Bye bye.